You're listening to Black Parents Aging, where we help you navigate caring for aging loved ones. Every Wednesday, we'll discuss how to help your parents successfully navigate this new season of life. We are going to talk about legal, health, technology, and finances. Here's your host attorneys, Olivia Smith and Nicola Robinson.
Hey, everybody, and welcome to another episode of Black Parents Aging. I am super excited. It's Olivia in the chair today. My partner, Nicola, is out, so I am helming by myself today, but I have a guest, and I promised you that I would do some digging and find this person after I'd done a previous episode about race-related stress in older adults, and I thought that was really interesting. And so, true to my word, I found the person behind the report, and she is here with us today, and I am super excited. Frances, welcome.
Thank you. I'm happy to be here and excited to speak with you today.
We are super excited to have you. I think this conversation will be so helpful to so many people. So I'm really excited to just dive right in. Can you just kind of give us a little bit about who you are and what is your background?
Sure. So obviously my name is Dr. Frances Adamako. I graduated from Howard University's Counseling and Psychology program. So I'm a very proud Bison. My area of focus is in race-related stress. So understanding the impact of racism on mental health. That's the work that I've been doing even prior to graduate school. And obviously in graduate school, I focused primarily in that area. Since 2015, some of my work has shifted to really focus on the impact of activism and how that relates to both racism and mental health. And so I'm currently actually an American Psychological Association fellow, which is through the Office of the Minority Fellowship Program, where I have a whole program at the Washington, D.C. VA that's specifically targeted towards addressing racism and mental health with veterans. And so that's the work that I'm engaged in right now. It's exciting work. It's very hard work, but I love it.
You've just given me so much. I'm giddy over here. So let me start by just asking, why did you decide for this to be your focus? What was your decision and why did you make that decision to kind of focus on this area?
Sure. So I think I've always been an observer, and that is actually the strength. And it's a strength that I use even currently in my clinical work. My parents are originally from Ghana, West Africa, and I was born there as well. We immigrated here when I was 10 years old to Bridgeport, Connecticut, which is a very urban area. And I was lucky enough to go to a magnet school, but the magnet school was situated within like the regular public school. And being someone who's very observant, I started noticing how folks who looked different were treated differently. Mm-hmm. And so even at the age of 10, I started to notice like equity related issues. At that point, I didn't really have the language and I didn't understand the history of race and racism.
Sure.
But I just started seeing like, oh, this person is treated differently, or these people are getting access to certain things. And why aren't these people? So I just started noticing that. And unfortunately, our education system in high school and elementary school doesn't really do a good job of really providing you with context. It wasn't until I went to college and I studied sociology and I started studying sociology of the Black experience that I really got to understand the social construction of race in this country, where it comes from, why I was noticing the things that I started to notice. And I just developed a passion for wanting to understand that, because it helped me to understand my own experiences as well as those people around me. And that has just carried forward. I was particularly inspired by, unfortunately, the murder of Trayvon Martin and what happened with him and all of the protests. I've had some amazing mentors throughout my educational career who really were about social movements and how those were necessary part of making systemic changes. And so from that experience and what happened with Trayvon Martin, it kind of just was like perfect in really inspiring me to focus in this area and also gaining a deeper sense of awareness of how people were responding and reacting and managing kind of like the emotional impact that these different events that were occurring were having in their lives.
So I want to ask you about you being someone who wasn't born in this country. And in some ways, getting to be sort of a voyeur of like how race works in this country, even though you moved here when you were 10, what is that experience? Because I only know the experience of, you know, that's been a part of my life since I was born. And so I'm always interested in the experience of someone who wasn't born here and then moves here and observes it playing out, observes the system kind of playing out. Can you talk just a little bit about that experience?
Yeah. So it's weird because I'm both like an observer and I'm also involved, right? Because I'm not excluded from that experience either. And so I think for me, like, I think initially it was a protective factor, the fact that I wasn't born here. And so it wasn't ingrained in me that I was a Black person. Like, I didn't even know what being a Black person really meant when we moved here. And so I understood myself to have a very different relationship with my race. I mean, I knew I looked like other people, but my experience was very different. And so I think it helped me to have some distance to it, right? Yes. So because I went to a magnet school and it was within the public school, there were some classes that we would take separately, but then some classes we would take with the entire school. And so I remember when I would take like my elective courses, which would be with the people in the other school, like teachers would make certain comments like, oh, like you're not going to go to college. Like, who are you? And things like that. And I was like confused, like, why would they say that to this person? And I would go back and share with my parents and they didn't understand it because of course they're immigrants. And so they don't understand that, you know, certain people, because of your skin color, that you're basically seen as someone who's not going to amount to anything.
Right.
And my parents would say, well, they don't know what they're talking about. Like, you're not like those people. You're African, you're fine. You're going to be fine regardless. So I didn't absorb those messages, messages in the same way as someone whose experience of just being born here would ideally absorb those messages as well. So it bounced off of me in a particular way, but it wasn't enough, right? It was like, it helped in the beginning, but as I was growing older and being acculturated in this country, it wasn't enough. And so I still am impacted by Right. So I guess it's both.
It's definitely a unique perspective for those of us that have only been, you know, born here and only known one way. So let's get into your work and just kind of talk to us about what is the stress. I think we all have our own individual understanding of the stress related to being African-American in this country. But can you just talk to us a little bit about what your work has been centered around and kind of what you found regarding that?
Absolutely. So racism-related stress is what happens to an individual when they experience racism. And that racism can come from a variety of different experiences like harassment, discrimination, even violence, right? So it's the symptoms that come from that. So just because you experience racism doesn't necessarily mean that it translates into racism-related stress. So the stressors that come from that experience. So if you find yourself being like more hypervigilant, right? And that level of like thinking like, when is this going to happen to me again? Or even more so, unfortunately, in more recent years, we've been seeing more of that collective trauma when we see those images and videos in the media. And we may not have experienced it directly, but we're witnessing this happen. And we're all kind of going through those same type of emotional consequences of that, right? So thinking like, when is this going to happen again to somebody else? Could it even happen to me? All of these like kind of intrusive thoughts and processes that we go through whenever we witness or hear of someone going through these experiences. So that those are the stressors that result in racism related stress. And so my work has been about unpacking that. So yes, we go through that. But what does that mean? How do we then live our lives? How does it then impact us in our behaviors, in the way we see ourselves, in the way we see ourselves in relation to our racial group membership? And then what do we do as a result? So oftentimes, those types of experiences can lead us to, you know, think negatively about ourselves as Black people in this country, maybe even be afraid to drive to certain places or get in the car, depending on what your experiences have been, have, you know, certain relationships. Sometimes, you know, I've heard of people like not even really wanting to get around or be around other Black people, right? Because of what it might mean if there's a gathering of Black folks, what will it mean in terms of the potential consequences or things that can happen to them? So the sense of isolation, kind of disconnect from the community that can oftentimes happen, that self-blame, that lack of self-esteem, even self-worthiness, thinking that are we cursed? Like, I've heard people thinking like, we're destined for bad things to always happen. So how do these stressors or these events make you feel about yourself, your racial group membership? And then what do you do as a result of that? So a lot of my work has been trying to heal people, mm-hmm. work with people through that process of understanding not only what those stressors are, but how it impacts them on an individual level, and then what they can do about it so that they can manage the effect. Now, some of my work has also been about, because racism is not really experienced just on an individual level, there is that collective experience. So our healing strategies also have to be collective as well. Mm. So you both need to do that individual interpersonal work, but you also have to do the collective work, because the ultimate goal is not to just cope through
right.
that. The ultimate goal is to stop this from happening, period. So we don't have to cope. What I want folks to do is do both, to both heal as individuals, but then also work towards our collective liberation so we don't have to just cope.
So I get my question, whereas I am thankful for how technology now is, we're able to see it more. Don't know if it's happening more. It may have happened the same amount before, we just couldn't see it. But I'm wondering how us seeing it affects. Like, on one hand, I think that's great for court, for just like the public consciousness. But then on the other hand, it feels like trauma. And I've heard and saw on social media so many people just saying how they're tired. Like, every day they wake up and it's something new, and how it just drains you. So can you talk a little bit about how it's both good and bad that we can now see it more?
Absolutely. I think that it's good to know what's happening, because we can't live in the dark and we can't pretend like these things are not going on. But one of the things that I always tell my clients is that you have to limit your exposure. So
yes.
I definitely limited my exposure, you know, with the recent case of what happened with Derek Chauvin. I saw maybe the beginning and then what happened at the end. I decided that I was not going to watch the trials, to go through the ups and downs. And so I always recommend to folks, like, figure out for you what mm-hmm. your are, what you can handle, and then act accordingly. So limiting your exposure is very, very important, because it's that re-traumatization process. And you also don't want to be desensitized to this too, which can happen when you see this over and over again. And you want to always stay connected with your emotions. So understand the impact it's having on you. Acknowledge it, you know, acknowledge the pain, acknowledge the fear that you're feeling as a result of this, but don't stay in it. Find a way to do other things to manage that, and don't allow yourself to be exposed. And it can be hard, because now we have social media.
Absolutely.
You can't really control all the time what's happening on your timeline, because there's other people posting. I also, even on my own social media, encourage people not to repost like mm-hmm. of George Floyd. Like, we have to collectively work towards that. And so I also encourage people to post things that actually help in the healing process. So nowadays, there's just so many different mental health organizations that have social media accounts. Repost those things, what the suggestions and tips that they are offering as to how to manage the feelings that are coming up, and not reposting the videos, because that's not helpful. And it's actually doing more harm than good for all of us, not just ourselves individually.
Absolutely. Okay. So I want to talk, you know, I've gotten off, I'm excited. So let's talk to why I brought you on in the first place. And it was because I ran across the report from the American Psychological Association, and it was talking about race-related stress specifically for older adults. And what really got me to thinking was when you were talking about the cumulative stressors. For a lot of us, it's our parents, right? So I said on the first episode, we thought that, like, our parents have lived through much worse than this. So like this, you know, where it would really affect us, maybe doesn't affect them the same because they lived through the civil rights movement and all of that. And so reading your report, I'm like, okay, that is probably not the right attitude to have. So can you talk to us a little bit about that?
Yeah, absolutely. So I do, because I work with a lot of veterans, a lot of my work is around post-traumatic stress disorder. And what happens a lot of times is like for older adults, right, these things have been happening across their lifespan. And so while, yes, they've lived through the civil rights movement, they've lived through worse atrocities, these recent events are actually triggering those memories that a lot of them may have put away, may have compartmentalized, may have distanced themselves against, right? And so what actually is happening is that they not only are dealing with, you know, what's happening now with their children and their grandchildren, and in some cases, their great-grandchildren, they are also dealing with their own life events of racism that they experience. And so making sense of all of that is really, really challenging because in some ways, some might think like, oh, we thought we had gotten away from it, but now my children are going through this. My grandchildren are going through this. And I'm also going through, because I'm living through and seeing it. And it's just like how it was, you know, when I was a child, and not only my own experience, but my parents' own experience.
Yes.
And so these are like, it's intergenerational trauma that they are all living through. And nowadays, the ways in which we talk about these experiences is very different from the way they may have or may not have talked about it before. I've heard a lot of children talk about how, you know, they never really talked to their parents about these experiences. They knew they went through them.
Right.
And every once in a while, they mentioned it when something happened, but they've never actually sat down with their parents and talked about what happened, how it impacted them, how they began to see the world as a result of it, how they might even begin to see themselves and the things that they actually did to navigate those experiences. And that is something that I think we need to start doing. And it can be hard to have those conversations, but we need to start asking, like, how did you manage? How did you handle? Yes. Maybe, you know, you successfully were able to navigate that, but how did you do that? And what are tips or advice or suggestions you can give me to be able to do that? Because as Black folks, or, you know, we operate on kinship networks, right? That is an integral part of our culture.
Absolutely.
And so that is a strength that we have. And so we need to lean into that because there are suggestions, advice, all types of things that our parents can offer us to be able to navigate what we're going through. And even if, you know, they weren't successfully able to do that, there are things that we can learn from and take with us and carry forward. So I think it's important for us to have those conversations. One, it allows that individual, that older adult, to process their own experiences. And that part about processing is an important skill, to be able to talk through what happened to them, to talk through how they managed, how they navigated those experiences, to share that and pass that on is very, very important. And it's healing in and of itself.
So that's a good thing. So having our parents talk about their previous experiences or their previous trauma is a good thing. So I know a lot of us may shy away because we don't want them to think about it or we don't want them to remember it. But what I hear you saying is talking about it is cathartic and it is healing for them in and of itself, just having those conversations.
Absolutely. I mean, just because you don't talk about it doesn't mean it didn't happen. It doesn't
Absolutely.
Is not thinking about it. So I think sometimes there's a misconception on our part to say, well, if we don't talk about it, then we can ignore it.
Right.
And when it comes to these really painful experiences, ignoring it is just not an option. Trying to push it down is not an option because pushing it down is also invalidating. And that's what we oftentimes experience as people of color in this country, is that we go through, you know, when we experience racism, oftentimes it's not acknowledged, it's dismissed. And so we can perpetuate that same type of behavior by acting like it never happened, even though that may not be our intention,
right?
That could be the impact. And so, you know, we need to be able to talk about it, and not that you have to keep revisiting and revisiting it,
sure.
But talk about it in a way that the person can talk about their experiences, but maybe focus more so on how did you manage, offer any suggestions, how can we do things to make you feel a sense of security and comfort, because maybe they weren't comforted when that happened. So can we attend to that now?
That's really good. So I want to ask you about one other aspect when I think about race-related stress that I think about, and then I want to get to some of your suggestions for us about how to handle our stress and how to address stress with our parents and just be monitoring that. So the last thing I want to ask about is the fear factor, because I feel like with race-related stress, a lot of that goes back to the fear of being in a Black body in this country and kind of what that means for me and safety, fear and safety. And so I want to ask you about that aspect. And then you can just talk about what are some of the ways that we can help heal ourselves. And I know you'd mentioned the collective healing strategy. So I want to talk a little bit about that as well.
So unfortunately, you know, no one can take away the fear. You know, I can't, you can't, we can't take that away. One of the things that we need to remember when we're thinking about how fearful it is to exist in this Black body in this country is that it has also been dangerous in the past. I always lean to my ancestors. Mm-hmm. You know, there was a time when it was just as violent, if not more so, and they persevered and they thrived and they made a way. So the fear is always going to be there. I feel it as a Black person myself. We can't take that away. No one can really take it away unless we dismantle this system. But what we can do is remind ourselves that we are made of very strong stuff. We're not going anywhere. We're going to continue to persevere and rise above whatever challenges that we're experiencing. And the people that have come before us also face that same fear. And I think we need to walk in that. And it's weird to say that, and it can be still feel uncomfortable to say that, but that's what gives me strength. Even when I'm encountering situations where I know that, you know, I'm a minority, especially in certain spaces, certain areas. And so, you know, I have to be careful the way I navigate certain areas. At the same time, I walk knowing that it's not always just me existing in a space, that I have the people that came before me with me all the time. So I think like sometimes thinking through that allows you to kind of reduce some of that fear a little bit, and also always taking precautions to be mindful not only of where you are, but who you're around. I strive to live in areas where there's mostly people who look like me. And I know that that's a privilege. Not everybody can do that. And I want to acknowledge that. So to the extent to which you can also surround yourself with a community that is integral to our survival and our ability to thrive. And then not just maybe where you live, but think about where you work, your friends, who are the people that you're sharing certain experiences with. And it could be family, but it could also be friends. It could be people in your professional network. So how do you build community around yourself so that you have people who understand your experiences, who look like you, who have similar cultural backgrounds to you, and you can go to talk about some of these things, and you can feel safe knowing that you're in connection with some people. So you're not isolated and alone. So it could be both physical, but also in terms of just extended networks and relationships as well.
So what should we be doing as far as our parents are concerned? Should we be, you know, inviting them for walks and turning the TV off? What are the things that we can do to kind of help with their stress? Because I think as children of aging parents, I think that is one of the kind of responsibilities we have, to always be checking in on our parents to make sure they're good. So in this area, what are the things that we need to be looking for to see if they are being, if they're stressed out, or if maybe we need to get them to talk to somebody? And what are the things that we can be doing to kind of help relieve that and provide some sort of help escape?
Yeah. And I know it can be hard because we're in a pandemic. And so a lot of us, unfortunately, have not been able to either see our parents or be in close physical contact with them as we normally do. I think the first thing is to look at the context. So there are older adults who are living in assisted living facilities or nursing homes.
Sure.
I would encourage you to think about, so what is being done for them to explore these issues in those spaces? So are they giving them, you know, extra support to be able to talk to people if they want to talk to someone about these issues? Are they also creating like culturally affirming programming to let them celebrate their culture, let them celebrate who they are? Because maybe not a lot of places do that. You know, some of these facilities, they do a very blanket approach. And so advocating for that in that facility where that person is living. And then if we're living with our older adults, because most of us do, you know, making sure to, definitely take them for walks, definitely try to connect with them and also keeping them safe. Unfortunately, what happened with COVID is that a lot of us living in intergenerational households, because we were going out to work and doing all of these different things, our older adults were really impacted by COVID
because absolutely
getting infected at a higher rate. So really being thoughtful about how we navigate the world to make sure that they are protected as a result of that, but also making sure to bring the kids around them, right? Like not making them feel like they are alone, including them in a lot of the things that we're doing. I mean, I went to some of the protests last summer. I saw a lot of older adults who could go there who were like, yes, I'm going to be there because I was there and I marched during the civil rights movement. I want to be there. So like not keeping these issues away from them as if they can't relate or they won't understand. I think having being as inclusive as possible is really, really important as well. And asking them what they need. You know, they may not want to. They may say, you know what, I'm okay. I just want to do what I'm doing and that's fine, and not pushing it, but giving them the space, treating them as full human beings and giving them the space to be able to explore those issues if they want to.
I think those are all great tips. And that last point is something that we bring out a lot. I think sometimes when people get older, we treat them as if they've returned to being a child and they are still a full adult. A full adult. So I think that point is absolutely well received. For those of us that want to know more about this area, what are organizations that we should be looking at, maybe following on social media, and where can we go to learn more?
Thankfully, I think with the age of social media, new media, there's just so many different mental health associations that are out there that talk about racism-related stress and other aspects of just Black mental health and Black mental wellness in general. And I think as children of aging parents, right, we're not just children of aging parents. There's many other aspects of our lives that it would be helpful for us to seek resources around just to manage just the complexity of just being a Black person in this country. And so there is definitely like Therapy for Black Girls Thrive. There's blackmentalwellness.org. That's another organization that I really love. There's BEAM, which I'm going to butcher the acronym, but I think it's like Black Emotional, like mental health or something like that.
If you give me those, I'll put them in the show notes. So then all of our listeners can go there and get all of the resources for sure.
Yeah, definitely. So I'll make sure to do that. The American Psychological Association always has wonderful webinars as well that are for African-Americans or just multicultural awareness in general. So I can definitely give you some links to additional webinars related to this topic specifically. And other than that, I think like those are just generally the ones that come to mind because they're so active and they put out so much information on a daily basis. And one thing that I will say is like just at least connect with one mental health organization on your social media. If not for anything, it helps to break up kind of like that daily, just like daily onslaught of the intense emotions and things that come out on people's timeline. Having at least one Black mental health organization allows you to gain some perspective, for you to get some tips and skills, maybe even things you weren't even thinking of, but it allows you to break up that constant just onslaught of different things that happen on your timeline. And I just think it's a really great way to stay connected and just stay aware in terms of just your mental health and well-being. And we all need to be doing that, especially during this time.
Absolutely. Dr. Francis, thank you so much. This, you know, I was thinking as we were talking, I was like, okay, we're going to need another part to this, but you just had so much information and I know our listeners are going to appreciate and get so much out of it. So thank you so much for taking the time out to talk to us. And to our listeners, as you know, we always like to hear feedback. We like to hear what you think about the episode. We like to hear suggestions. We want to hear from you so that our podcast episodes are responsive to the things that you're interested in and needed. So you can always contact us on social media, on Facebook, on Instagram. We want to hear from you, and we will talk to you again, same time, same place next week.
You're listening to Black Parents Aging, where we help you navigate caring for aging loved ones. Every Wednesday, we'll discuss how to help your parents successfully navigate this new season of life. We are going to talk about legal, health, technology, and finances. Here's your host attorneys, Olivia Smith and Nicola Robinson.